Good morning, Cornerstone. See, I said something the first service that a lot of us are getting a complex. That JL comes up and there's like the wave starts and there's people are throwing clothing at him and it's just weird. And then it's like, oh yeah, there's Pastor Jeff and all the rest, you know. But it's good. That was good. That was a good move. Thank you very much. It's great to have you here this morning. We welcome you to our service. If you're worshiping with us on the web, wherever you are, we want to welcome you. If you are a first-time visitor, we'd love to have you fill out the flap. The flap is a little card in the seat in front of you. If you'd fill that out, and again, you're a first-time visitor, by all means, take it to the Welcome Center. The Welcome Center has a gift for you, and they'd love to get to know you a little bit better, so please stop by there. This is really that time of year where things are really taking off. Yesterday, from morning to well into the evening, there was something going on all the time yesterday. So how do you know what's happening? And the answer is you keep an eye on the announcement loop and watch the loop, stay in the loop, I think is what some famous person once said. And so we want you to know what's going on and join. There's still time to join our small groups and that kind of thing. If you're interested, some of them are gearing up and starting this week and in the next couple weeks. So we hope you'll take advantage of that. We're doing really well with the cell phones. The crying has really been kept to a minimum, and not that for children, and they can go in that room over there. but there's this walking thing that we want to get a hold of here a little bit. If you would, you know, we ask people don't stand up during the service and walk down and do cartwheels down the middle aisle or any of that kind of thing. So some people don't think you're talking to them. So I want you to turn to the person next to you and say, he's talking to you. Okay, there you go. So there you go. Today we're starting a new series in James for the next five Sundays. It's exciting. And the Essential James, it's called. And we're going to be talking about thinking. And a lot of things start with thinking before we start acting. And so it starts up here. And if we can get a hold of that and align it with God, good things can happen. And if we don't, not so much. So that's the series today. And we're excited to have Pastor Brenda back from her much-needed vacation. But as you know, sometimes you need a vacation to rest from the vacation. And that's kind of how this one was. So give her some space. She's a little wound up today. No, I'm just kidding. We want you to meet and greet each other. But before you do, you got to answer a question. Stand up and welcome the person around you and tell them the most famous person you've ever personally met. Go ahead.
Morning. Let's praise our God.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see. Praise. Hallelujah. Worthy is
Would you join me in prayer? Loving God, we thank you. We thank you so much for being a God who welcomes us, receives us as we are. But God, you love us too much to leave us in those places. And so you work through others. You work through your word, through your Holy Spirit, to take us to a new place. And for that, we give you thanks. Lord God, we thank you for the beauty of this weather, this season of fall where it gets colder. Help it to remind us, God, that we should never become cold in our faith. We should always warm up to you. We should always seek you. And not only that, to bring that out in others, to let others know that we're not cold, but we're on fire for you. Lord God, many here today came with all kinds of baggage, uncertainty, fear, sickness, depression and loneliness. Some come with lies and dark places in their life that they really don't want to share with anybody, but you know those. Some come with confusion, not sure where to go and what path to take. Lord God, I just pray for all those issues, all those things that we bring today. Help us not to leave this place with them. Let us to put them at the feet of the cross, right at your Son's feet, God, so that we might be able to worship you in spirit and in truth and with freedom that comes from knowing you. Lord God, I thank you for all these prayers that have gone up today. I pray for Pastor Brenda. She brings a message and opens your word to show us that we have a path that is found in you. So help us, O God, as we continue our time of worship. And all these things we ask in Jesus' precious name. Amen.
What do you think about? What do you think about as you live your life each day? At home, at work, at school, at practice or play? What do you think about? Any subject under the sky? What do you think about? But not just what, also why. What do you think about? Hasn't anyone ever asked you that before? Because I know that you do think about things all the time and have strong opinions too. So, what do you think about your parents' divorce, or God forbid yours, or all the countries in the world plagued by disease, famine, and war? What do you think about our troops fighting overseas, the conflicts in the Middle East? Is there even a chance for peace? What do you think about our president's approval rating, or the chances you have to ever be officially dating? What do you think about prayers in public schools, evolution versus creation, or all of your parents' rules? What do you think about the environment, hybrid cars, or the fake IDs your friends got to try and sneak into bars? What do you think about tax cuts and limits on immigration, gun control, abortion, health care, or any other form of litigation? What do you think about Africans who can't get water that's clean are dying of AIDS by the millions while their cries go unheard and they go unseen? What do you think about the guy who's always sitting alone, the girl across you from English, or your little brother back home? What do you think about in 10 years where you'll be? Will you have a job, a house? Will you have started a family? What do you think about the doctrine of the Trinity, the Lordship of Christ, or that God has existed for infinity? What do you think about faith versus works, or even how the Bible is taught in your church? What do you think about Muslims and Jews? Do they believe the same things you do, worship the same God as you? What do you think about preachers who mess up? Should they hide their own sin or come clean and fess up? What do you think about your youth group back home? Do you grow in your faith, or just keep the status quo? Strangers you meet on the street, your best friend for 5 years, or all the people you've yet to meet. What do you think about color, race, sex, and creed, or what responsibility you have to try and meet another's needs? What do you think about the ACLU, CIA, and FEMA? What do you think about our country's responses to Katrina? What do you think about faith, hope, and love? Is hell an actual place and heaven for real up above? What do you think about? It's up to you to make up your mind, to ask the right questions of the right sources, so the answers you will find. Don't assume you've got it right. Don't think that you've got it all figured out. Take some time in your life to actually examine what you think about. Don't just be to the pattern of this world conformed, but leave your mind in God's hands and watch it be completely transformed. Because it's not about politics or religion, though Those things certainly have their place, but I'm asking you to think loftier than that. What do you think about truth, about faith? So stop concerning yourself with what's good, better, noble, or nice. Set all that aside and just focus on how you might think like Christ.
Well, that was really encouraging. That video got a lot of amens there this morning. So that encourages me. That gives me hope that you're going to be with it on the sermon this morning, okay? I got it. Because you know what that guy said is absolutely true? How we think is so important, because the Bible tells us the way we think directs our lives. This morning we're going to look at three specific areas and look at how we think in those areas, how it makes our life turn out. Now, the whole Bible is important. The reason it's important is because the Bible is God's word. It tells us what God thinks. It tells us what he thinks is important, and he should know, right? So we're looking at God's word. It's important because it is God's word. And the whole Bible has two themes. It has two themes. The first theme is it tells us how to get the way to God, how to find the way to God. And that part of the Bible, all of those things in the Bible are directed towards people that the Bible would say, the way the Bible phrases it, these are people who are lost in their sins. Okay? Lost in their sins. They don't know God. And then the second theme of the Bible is for those people who have crossed the line. They've accepted Christ as their Savior. And now that they've asked him to forgive their sins and that they've said that he's Lord of their lives and that they want to follow him, now this is the way that we're supposed to live now that we've been saved. When you look at the Bible, the Bible is Old Testament and New Testament. The Old Testament sets the stage for Christ to come. And the New Testament, the first four books, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, they tell the story of Jesus' life from a couple different perspectives, all the truth, the stories all blend, but they tell the story from the perspective of four of his friends. And then the book of Acts comes right after that, and that is a book that tells the story of the early church right after Jesus went to heaven. And then most of the rest of the New Testament is a series of letters that leaders in the church, under the inspiration of God, wrote to people just like you and me. Most of us here this morning, most of us would be people who have crossed the line. Most of us this morning have accepted Christ as our Savior. And so now we're needing to hear about how to walk the walk. And that is the message of the whole book of James. The book of James talks to us over and over again in a variety of ways that it is not enough to talk the talk. It's not enough to say the right things. Now we have to walk the walk. There are certain ways that we are supposed to live once we've come to know Christ as our Savior. Now, the author identifies himself in the very beginning, right there in verse 1 of James. James says, James, a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes scattered among the nations. James was the half-brother, the physical brother of Jesus Christ. He was born to Joseph and Mary, and you remember that Jesus' father was God himself, but his human mother was Mary, and his stepdad, as it were, was Joseph, and he was raised there in this home. And then his brother was James. But by this time, we see a big change in James' life. When we read the New Testament, we read in the book of Mark that Jesus was doing things and he was talking to people in ways that sounded, I guess, so highfalutin to his brothers, that his brothers, it says, came to where he was and tried to persuade him to go home. And do you know what it says? The Bible says that James and his brothers told people, he's taken leave of his senses. Because, you know, I've thought that about my brothers before. Have you ever thought that about your brothers? Okay, well, by the time he writes this, James' opinion has changed about his brother so much. His opinion has changed about his brother so much that he calls himself a servant of God and of the Lord Jesus Christ. Now, I was a slave to my brothers when I was growing up sometimes, but never willingly. And I certainly wasn't the kind of servant that he was. He's saying, I have chosen to serve him with my life. That's who he is. Okay, so this is James, Jesus' brother. He's witnessed his life. He's heard his teachings. He knows who he is. He knows that he's God's son. And he's writing to people to tell them how to live a life that follows Christ. And it says specifically that he's writing to the 12 tribes who have been scattered. Now, this happened after, when you're reading the book of Acts, when you come to Acts chapter 8, you will find that there's a great persecution going on. And this is when Stephen, who was one of the leaders of the early church, when he was stoned for his faith, that, you know, they were so angry at him for the truth that he was telling that they stoned him. And after that, the persecution was so widespread that believers just fled all over the place. Jewish people, that's why it was called the 12 tribes. These are Jewish people from the 12 tribes of Israel who had put their faith in Christ, and now they're scattering all over the nations, everywhere they could get to keep from being killed at this point in time. Now, because they had to leave their home, they were like any immigrant today. They were homeless, they were landless, they were poor. This is who they were. And he's writing them to tell them, you need to stay steady. This is how in your situation, this is how you should think in order to live right. This is the way you should think as believers. And that's where we pick it up. Now, so as I said before, the main theme of the book is that you can't just talk your faith. You have to walk your faith. If you've put your faith in Jesus Christ, it's supposed to change you. There's supposed to be as much difference between a person who knows Jesus Christ as Savior and one who doesn't as there is between a dead person and a live person. That's what the Bible says. Jesus said that. Now, if you go to the funeral home this afternoon, it's not going to take you very much time to figure out who the dead person is, right? Yeah. It's going to be real obvious who's dead and who's alive. And that's what the Word of God says is supposed to be that with you and I. When we come to life in Jesus Christ, when we come to know Him as Savior, there's supposed to be a big change. Big change, that big of a change for us. So he starts saying, when he's talking to us about how we should think, he says these words, consider it. Consider it. What does consider mean? Consider means to give a weighty opinion, to think about it, and to decide, to make a decided opinion. Consider it. So that's what he's telling us. He's telling us now all the stuff he talks to us about. It's not going to be a random thought that just pops into your mind. It's not going to be a natural response. He's going to say you're going to have to think about it. You're going to have to consider it. And you're going to have to decide, this is the way I'm going to think. And that's where we take off this morning. Listen to what he says. He says, the way I think about my trials, first thing, the way I think about my trials directs the outcome. Listen to these verses from chapter 1. Consider it, remember, decide to think this way is what he's saying. Decide to think that it is pure joy, my brothers and sisters, whenever you face trials of many kinds. That doesn't sound natural, does it? That's going to have to be a choice. Decide it is pure joy, my brothers and sisters, when you face trials of many kinds. Now, another important thing here, you notice he didn't say, if you face trials, he said, when. How many of you would say, I'm facing a trial, I'm in a trial right now? Let's see your hands. Okay, I'm going to say roughly a third of us are facing a trial right now. The rest of you don't feel left out. You'll probably be in one before the week's over, okay? That'll be good. He said, whenever you face trials of many kinds, and we know that what's a trial to me may not be a trial to you, right? Because our trials are many kinds. Sometimes they're financial, sometimes they're relational, sometimes they're emotional, sometimes they're physical. All different kinds of things. We face all different kinds of trials. Because you know that the testing of your faith produces perseverance. Let perseverance finish its work so that you may be mature and complete, not lacking anything. Wow. Consider it, decide to think that my trials are pure joy. Whew, that's crazy, right? Consider it pure joy. Why? Because the way I think about my trials determines the outcome when I get to the other side of my trials. Isn't it funny how when we're in a hard place, we feel like that our hard place is harder than anybody else's hard place? We were just down in Pigeon Forge in Gatlinburg for vacation, and you know the altitude is much higher there than it is here, and most of us carried some kind of a low-grade headache throughout the week because of the change of the altitude. It's just kind of hard. And it's kind of fun because occasionally we had, you know, just a few light skirmishes over whose headache was worse, you know. Well, mine is worse because I'm pregnant. Well, mine is worse because I'm old. And mine is, you know, that kind of thing. Isn't it funny how when we're in a hard place, we feel like it's harder than anyone else is experiencing? Yeah, we really do. But we all face trials of many different kinds. And how we think about them determines the outcome. God says that. God says that. And this is what he says to choose to think about them. First of all, choose to think that they are taking me someplace good. He said, when you're in a hard time, choose to think that these trials are taking you someplace good. And what's the good place? Maturity. Maturity. They're taking me to a good place, to maturity. Have you ever noticed that people who get to quit all the time as kids, their parents let them quit? You know, they quit playing ball the first time the coach yells at them. You know, they quit piano lessons the first time they get tired of practicing. Or, you know, they quit this team because they don't like the people on it. They quit going to church because it's boring. They quit all this kind of stuff and their parents are just good with it. Have you ever noticed that those people grow up to be quitters too? Yeah, they do. Just pay close attention. Most of you are going to live long enough yet that if you haven't noticed it yet, watch a kid now. Watch a kid around junior high that gets to quit all the time. And watch him or her when they're young adults. They quit on everything too. They quit this job because it's not good enough. They quit on marriage. They quit on relationships. They quit on all different kinds of stuff. They quit on everything. Why? Because they've never learned that to get to the good stuff, you have to push through the hard stuff. That's just part of it. And this is what God is telling us. When you're in a trial, choose to think this way. It's taking me someplace good. It's taking me someplace good. When I get through this, I'm going to be grown up in a new way. I'm going to grow. I'm going to get maturity. It's going to take me someplace good. Now, here's the truth that you and I need to all get a hold of. We have an enemy. Have you noticed that? Anybody noticed you have an enemy this week? Yeah. Well, we have an enemy. His name is Satan. And he does not want you to get to a good place. And so everything that's worth getting to is going to have some difficult moments in it. Every single time, a marriage that works out to be really, really good, it means that people have pushed through some hard times. Every now and then someone will say something to Charlie or me about our great marriage, and they'll say, wow, you know, we wish we had it as easy as you do. You know, I've people tell me, if I was married to Charlie, I'd have a good marriage too. Well, you know what? We've pushed through a lot of things. We have. We've pushed through a lot of things. One of the reasons that we have a great marriage, we've been married for 38 years, and one of the reasons that it's so good, and I love him, and I told him, well, it makes me feel emotional just telling it to you. When we were riding back from Tennessee, just the two of us in the car, we were having so much fun. We were playing alphabet, and we were listening. Charlie has a little shuffle, and he has this most amazing blend of songs that are on there, and he put them on, you know, where they mix them all up and they come up randomly, and I was cracking up. I said, only you, Charlie, only you would go from In the Garden to Blue Suede Shoes. Only you. Only you. We were having a great time, and we always have a great time, but do you know how we get to the great times? Because we pushed through some times that weren't so great. We pushed through some hard moments, and they're not all over. We just decide not to make big moments of them. You know, I can tell by looking at Charlie's face when he's overlooked something that we could have had a fight over. You know, I can see when I've annoyed him by something, I can see it on his face, and I can see that he chose to let that one go. And then I have to choose to let that look on his face go too, you know. But that's how you do it. Every time you get to a good place, it's because you push through some hard places. You go through the trials, and that's the way it is. Your enemy is not going to let you have anything good easy. It's always going to come hard. And if you drop and run, here's what I promise you. You will be a gray-headed 15-year-old. That's what you'll be. You'll be immature. You'll be hard to get along with. You'll never grow up because you drop and run. You quit every time it gets hard. He's saying you have to choose when you're in a trial to say, this is taking me someplace good, and the good place is growing up. Now, he talked about perseverance. What is perseverance? Perseverance is steadfastness in doing something, even if it's hard, and even if success doesn't come quickly. We could all hang in there if success came fast, right? We could all do that. You know, we could all do that. We'd all grow gardens if you could plant a tomato today and pick it on Tuesday, right? We'd all plant gardens, but you can't do it that way. Steadfastness. Perseverance. He said, this is what you have to do. You have to persevere. You have to choose to think when trials come to you, I will not give up. I will grow up. Right? It's what you have to choose. And it determines how you come out of your trial. Another thing that's really great, and we need to choose to think this way when we're in a trial, is that God will give me all the wisdom I need in this trial if I ask him. Listen to these verses. This is right in the middle of the trial. If any of you lacks wisdom, anybody feel that way? Anybody feel like you're not quite smart enough for the challenge you're facing right now? I feel that every single day of my life. But here's the good news. If any of you lacks wisdom, you should ask God, who gives generously to all without finding fault, and it will be given to you. But when you ask, you must believe and not doubt, because the one who doubts is like a wave of the sea blown and tossed by the wind. Those who doubt should not think they will receive anything from the Lord. They are double-minded and unstable in all they do. He says that when I'm in a hard place, when I'm in this place where I need to not give up, but I need to grow up, when I don't know what to do, when I feel unwise, I need to come to Him with faith, and I need to ask Him, what is it that I need to do? And believe that He will tell me. And He will do it. I just told somebody this week, listen, I don't know what you should do. I don't know exactly what you should do, because your problem's a big one. It's a personal one. But here's what I know you should do for the next thing to find out what to do. You should go someplace quiet and spend a lot of time with the Lord. And you should take a notebook, a journal. You should write down the thoughts. Ask God for wisdom. Ask Him what to do. Tell Him, I need your wisdom. I need you to show me what's the next thing to do. And listen to the thoughts that He puts in your head. Read the scripture. See what the scripture says to you. Write it down. And before long, you'll get a pattern. You'll know what your next step is to do. God promises to do that if you will ask and if you will believe. So, God will give you the wisdom that you need. Now, when you read on, you find out that God's wisdom is counterintuitive. Listen to this. Believers in humble circumstances ought to take pride in their high position. That doesn't sound like the world thinks, does it? Those of us who are in humble situations, we should take pride in that. The rich should take pride in their humiliation. What that means is when a rich person doesn't have it all, they should take pride in that too instead of feeling ashamed of it. Since they will pass away like a wild flower. The sun rises with scorching heat and withers the plant. Its blossom falls and its beauty is destroyed. In the same way, even the rich will fade away even while they go about their business. But blessed are those who persevere under trial, because when they have stood the test, they will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love Him. Wow, that's good stuff. He's saying it doesn't matter if you're rich or if you're poor. God's going to give wisdom to everyone who perseveres. And we shouldn't worry too much. We shouldn't be thinking, well, you know, if I just had more money, I could get out of this trial. If I just had more money, then, you know, my wife would be happier. If we just had money, our marriage would be better. No, he's saying it doesn't matter what your circumstances are. It doesn't matter that. You put your faith in me, you talk to me, you ask me for wisdom, you hang in there, God's going to grow you up. That's what he says. The way I think about my trials determines the outcome. Okay? Now, the next thing he talks about how we think, is very, very close, but significantly different. This area is about temptation. Now, trials are different than temptation. Sometimes people want to lump them all together, but they're actually quite different. Trials have God's fingerprints all over them. See, God will allow you to be in a trial, and He may even arrange a trial for you. He may let that happen to you in order to stretch your faith, to help you grow up. You know how that old saying goes, you know, you can't have any flowers without sunshine and rain, right? And God knows that, so He allows trials in our life. The trials have His fingerprints all over them. Temptation is the next area we're going to look at, and temptation has the devil's fingerprints all over it. Trials come from the outside of us. Temptations come from the inside of us. Very, very important difference. Trials will help us grow strong in a weak spot. Temptations will attack a weak spot and destroy us there. That's a couple of big differences. And this is what James tells us. The way I think about temptation determines my response. The way I think about temptation determines my response. And so again, he says, choose to think this way. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. Have you ever said that before? No. Have you ever thought that before? Sometimes people do. They say, well, you know what? If God didn't want me to go out with her, He shouldn't have let me meet her. You know? If God, here's my favorite one. If God didn't want me to eat that chocolate chip cookie, He shouldn't have had it laying there, you know? Isn't it funny how we can kind of blame things on God? Yeah. When tempted, no one should say, God is tempting me. For God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does He tempt anyone. But each of you is tempted when you are dragged away by your own evil desire and enticed. Then after desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin. It's just describing it like a pregnancy and a birth. After desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Doesn't always have to be physical death. It can be the death of a relationship, the death of a reputation, the death of hope. It leads to death. Don't be deceived, my dear brothers and sisters. Every good and perfect gift is from above, coming down from the Father of the heavenly lights, who does not change like shifting shadows. He chose to give us birth through the word of truth, that we might be a kind of first fruits of all he created. Choose to think about temptation correctly, because the way you think about it determines your response. Now, again, notice he doesn't say if you face temptation. He says when you face temptation. Let's see this. How many of you have been tempted in any way this week? Let's see your hands. Okay. The rest of you are either shy or you were tempted to lie and you just lied. Okay. Because we're all tempted, right? Our temptations are in different ways. You know, sometimes we're tempted to do things that don't seem so bad, and so, you know, we don't actually consider them temptations. But temptation is always present in life. To tempt means to entice with a promise of reward or gain or pleasure. That's actually what it means to tempt. And that is why advertising is done up so well. You know, the advertisements picture everything wonderful, and they just don't tell you the truth, right? They show, here's the truth. They show beautiful, skinny, model-looking ladies eating chocolate on the ads. That hasn't happened to me when I eat chocolate. No truth in advertising, right? And they'll promise you, you know, you see an advertisement. If you only have the right mouthwash, you can get dates with the most incredible people in the world. Have you noticed that? See, what they do, they tempt you, they entice you with something that is just not true. It's not telling the entire picture. And that is what temptation is. That's what the Bible just said. That's what James just told us. It comes from within. And temptation has Satan's fingerprints all over it. The first thing we know, and we have to think this way, we have to choose to think this way. God never tries to bait me. Ever. Ever. If you're in a temptation, and you're tempted between a good and wise thing and a not so good and unwise thing, don't think that God has set that up for you. God will never bait us. It says that. God will never be tempted, and he will never tempt us. Now, God will allow those hard trials into our lives to stretch us, to help us grow, but he will never traffic in immorality. Ever, never, ever. It's a matter of personal responsibility. God doesn't tempt me. When I'm tempted, when I get into sin, it's never God's fault. It's always me and the devil. We've struck out up a partnership. It's the two of us. That's how I get in trouble. Now, here's the truth, though. It's the second thing you need to choose to think about temptation. I am my own worst tempter. I'm even worse for me than the devil is. Now, this is going to tell your age if you laugh at this, because you'll know who he is. You remember Flip Wilson? Okay. Those of us who are old enough to know Flip Wilson know that he was a really funny character on TV. And his thing was, he'd dress up like a woman. It was always, the devil made me do it. Okay? Well, the devil is responsible for some bad stuff in my life, but I'm really responsible for most of my worst problems. Because of my own evil desires, and that's what James said. Sin comes from my own evil desires. I tell myself I can just take one taste, I can just take one look, I can just talk to her that one time, I can just do that one thing with him, and it'll never go anywhere. And then before we know it, what's happened? This sin has gotten huge. It's this evil desire has conceived, and it's given birth to great big sin, and it takes us to a bad place. I'm my own worst tempter. And you're your own worst tempter, because you can tell yourself lies and you believe them. I believe them. We tempt ourselves terribly. We're tempted by our own evil desires. Another thing we need to tell ourselves, and he tells us this so plainly, is that the temptation movie always ends badly. But God can be trusted. He tells us the truth. He tells us the truth. The temptation movie always starts out glamorous. It always starts out with the beautiful girls, the handsome guys, all the fun. That's the way the temptation movie starts. but it always ends badly. You know, you take that first drug to fit in, and it doesn't look so bad. But where does it end you up? It ends you up in a bad place. You have that little mild flirtation at work with that girl, and you know she's filling your ego. She's building you up a little bit, and it just feels pretty good. No harm here, but where does that movie end? Play it out. Play it out. Where does it end? Because this is what God tells us, and He's the one who knows. He says that our evil desires tempt us, and we give in to them. They give birth to sin, and sin, when it is conceived and brings forth a child, that child is death. That child is death. And every one of us here can think of things that have died in our lives because of sins that we let go. It might have been our marriage. It might have been a friendship. It might have been a reputation. It might have been our finances died. It might have been our health died. We can all think of things that have died because of a temptation that we believed the poor ad. We believed the misinformation that this was going to be all fun. Play the movie, friends. The way you think about temptation determines how you respond. On the other hand, he tells us, while bad stuff comes from Satan and comes from our evil desires, he says that all the good stuff comes from the Father. And that, I love the way he describes it. The Father of the heavenly lights. When the girls led us in worship this morning, I love that slide that had the different colors, you know, coming down, talking about, you know, clothed in light and clothed in all these beautiful colors. But that's not even, you know, that's not even a fraction of how light and wonderful our God is. And light stands for truth. Every good and perfect gift comes from the Father who tells the complete truth. He doesn't hide anything from us. Isn't that wonderful? His advertising is all for real. He says, if you do it my way, I'm going to protect you and I'm going to provide for you. And it's always true. It's always true. Always true. 100% of the time. Listen to Proverbs 10:22. The blessing of the Lord makes one rich with joy, and He adds no sorrow with it. Let me give you an illustration of what that means. If you buy a new car, brand new car, 2012 car, and you don't really have the money to buy it, you are going to have joy for less than 30 days. Then there's going to be a lot of sorrow added with it, right? Because you're going to have to pay and pay and pay and pay. Used to be when they first did car loans, you know, that it was 36 months and then 48 and then 60. And, you know, pretty soon you buy a car, you pay on it your whole life, pretty much. The things that give us pleasure in the short term often give us a lot of grief. And this is what God is saying. Listen, when you do things my way, when you obey me and you connect up with other people who obey me, I'm going to protect you, I'm going to provide for you, and the joy and the blessing that I give you will give no sorrow with it. There's going to be no bitter aftertaste in your mouth when you do things my way. Don't be deceived, he says. Our problems all come from inconsistent thinking. We can lie to ourselves. Isn't it crazy how we'd rather believe a lie than the truth? You know, it's that kind of thing when you know, us ladies were famous for this. Do I look fat in these jeans? Okay. Well, you already know you probably look a little bit fat in these jeans or you wouldn't ask. But all you need is for someone to tell you, oh, sweetheart, you look wonderful. And we're off to the races, right? Because we'd rather believe a lie than the truth. And that's where we are in all of life. It's very, very difficult for us to choose the truth. But God's word tells us that victory and joy come from living in the light and in the truth with the Father of light. The Father of light who always tells us the truth. Okay, the third area he tells us that it's really important how we think is about the way we think about God's standard. The way I think about God's standard directs my character. Wow. We don't even have to read the Bible to know that's true, right? Can't you just picture in your mind somebody who accepts God's standards? You know that they do. Okay, you get a hold on them, picture them in your head. All right? And then someone you know, it could be a celebrity, it could be someone you know personally who rejects God's standards. Get those two pictures in your mind. The character is black and white, night and day, right? Yeah, it's night and day. Absolutely, we know this is true, but listen to what God says about it. My dear brothers and sisters, take note of this. Everyone should be quick to listen, slow to speak, and slow to become angry. because our anger does not produce the righteousness that God requires. Therefore, get rid of all moral filth and the evil that is so prevalent, and humbly accept the word planted in you, which can save you. Do not merely listen to the word and so deceive yourselves. Do what it says. Those who listen to the word but do not do what it says are like people who look at their faces in a mirror and after looking at themselves go away and immediately forget what they look like. But those who look intently into the perfect law that gives freedom and continue in it, not forgetting what they have heard but doing it, they will be blessed in what they do. Those who consider themselves religious and yet do not keep a tight rein on their tongues deceive themselves, and their religion is worthless. Religion that our God, that our Father accepts as pure and faultless is this: to look after orphans and widows in their distress, and to keep oneself from being polluted by the world. Wow. The way I think about God's standards directs my character. For too many of us, there's a great divorce. We think that what we believe is one thing and how we behave is another. And it's not supposed to be that way. In fact, God says it can't be that way. It's one and the same. I remember my brother Jay, before he was the fine godly man that he is today, and I'm not saying that as a joke. Jay is one of my heroes. I love and admire him. But listen, before he was a committed Christian, when he was out in the world, he was a truck driver, and there was a restaurant, a truck stop, that he used to stop at in the mornings and eat breakfast a lot. And one day, my brother Dwight, who was our younger brother, came there to the truck stop to eat breakfast with Jay. Now, Jay would be the very first one to tell you that he was not living for Jesus in any way, shape, or form at that point in time, and neither were his friends. So they're all there this morning, and they're talking together. And when these guys find out that they got this young kid here that's studying to be a preacher, and you know that he's a Christian and everything, they're asking him questions, and Dwight's answering these questions the best that he can, and he's sharing his testimony and just saying, "Well, this is just what I believe, and this is what God has done for me." And there's a little bit of laughter, and one of the guys kind of made a little bit of fun of Dwight. And Jay, with great courage and a beet red face, said, "Listen, you guys, I believe it just exactly the way he said it. I believe everything that he said, but I'm not living it." That took courage. That took courage to say that. Was it wrong? Yeah, it's wrong. You can't do that. But it took courage to say that, because the truth is, there's a bunch of us here this morning that's where we are. We believe a lot of stuff that we don't live. You know, we'd say we believe it, but we don't live it. And God is saying his standard is that can't be. They have to be one and the same. Belief and behavior need to match up. It needs to command my practice. Whatever I believe needs to determine the way that I live. James starts off by telling us, lead with your ears. He says, be quick to hear. Be quick to hear. Listen. Listen more than you talk. Listen. Be quick to hear. And then choose that. Choose to believe that, and these are hard things to believe, but they're true. Choose to believe that, choose to think that, my anger, my personal anger, will never achieve God's purposes. That's hard to take, isn't it? That's hard to take. My anger will never accomplish God's purpose. You hear that? He says, our anger does not produce the righteousness that God desires. Wow. Have you ever tried to teach somebody a lesson? You're just really ticked off and you're like, I'm going to teach them a lesson. Let me just ask you, did they learn anything?
No.
Were you miserable?
Yep.
Yes, absolutely. It doesn't help. Our anger does not produce the right kind of stuff. It just doesn't do it. Let me give you a good example. All right? Now track with me here. Tell me the truth whether you want to or not. Does God's word say that homosexuality is a sin?
Yes.
Yes, it does. Okay? But are we to be angry about it? No. Here's something that just really, really just fries me. This really fries me. I hate the ugly, awful things that Christians will do and say they're doing them in the name of Christ. Isn't it terrible?
Yes.
It's a terrible thing. Because here's the truth. You know, we'll occasionally see parades and pickets and all these kind of things against homosexuality. And some of the very people that are picketing that are living with somebody they're not married to, or they're having sex with someone, and God says that's just as wrong as homosexuality. It's just another sin, you know, garden variety sin. All of it is. It's just wrong. It's just wrong. But, you know, we don't go to, if you know that your child, your adult child is living with someone they're not married to, do you go to their house and picket? No, of course you don't. Of course you don't do that. Of course you don't do that. You know that your anger, displaying it in that way, will not produce anything good, right? So why do we want to handle other things that way? I tell you what, I would hate to be any of those people from that ridiculous thing called a church in Texas, where they, you know, picket soldiers' funerals and they treat homosexuals so poorly. I just think, wow, you guys are going to fry someplace bad because God is going to take care of you. How terrible to act that way. Our anger does not produce what God requires, and that's righteousness. It just doesn't do it. And even in our homes, when we fly off and we just figure that somebody's going to have a piece of my mind today, does it work out very well? No. Our anger does not produce the righteousness God requires. Does that mean that we should just be pushovers and let anything go anytime? No. No, but there's ways to handle it, and it's not with our anger. It's not our anger. We can't do that. When we do the right thing in the wrong spirit, it's wrong, right? Right thing done the wrong way is wrong. It's just wrong. My anger, I have to choose to think that way because it doesn't feel that way. We'll say we're filled with righteous indignation. If it's righteous indignation, it has to be something that God would be mad at, and it has to be handled in the way God would handle it. And that cuts off almost everything. You know, it changes almost everything. And then the next thing he says, we have to choose to think that knowledge demands action. When I know something, I have to do something about it. It's better not to know if I'm not going to do anything about it. Knowledge demands action. Down there in Pigeon Forge, it's really funny on the big main parkway that goes through the town, runs all the way through Seaverville and Pigeon Forge up into Gatlinburg. If you've been there before, you know how that big parkway is. And I don't get it. I don't get it. But people bring lawn chairs and they sit out there on the parkway all day long and watch old cars, the rods, go up and down, you know, the road and park and look at them and all this kind of stuff. I told Charlie, I said, honey, if retirement has even one day of this in it, we got to have a talk because I can't picture that. I can't picture it. Now, the one thing I could picture spending some time doing is people watching. I think people are a lot more interesting than old cars. And sometimes if I don't like to go to the mall, but if I go to the mall, I don't mind sitting in the mall and watch people come by. Now, I understand. I never try to be a fashion plate. I know that it's hopeless. I don't try to be the most beautiful woman in the world. I know that's hopeless. I just try to look presentable and not cause any child, small child, to gasp in horror when they see me. You know, that's what I'm shooting for. But do you ever see people that honestly, you're not going to say it out loud because you're not mean, but when you see them out in public, you go, yeah, did you look in the mirror before you left home? Do you ever think that? Or you think, I have this thought all the time. Is there nobody in your life who loves you? I think, you know, somebody who loved you would say, comb that hair for pity's sakes, or wash your face or something. Now, here's the truth. Here's the truth. Some, you know, most of those people know what they look like. They just, you know, amble on out and kind of forget about it. Just, you know, have a good time. And that's what Jesus is saying we do when we hear the Word of God, when we read the Word of God. The Bible says, this is what it just said, that itself, this book of God's, is a mirror. It's a perfect mirror. And when you look in it, when you read it with an open mind, when you hear it preached with an open mind, God holds his mirror up in front of you, holds his mirror up in front of me, and we get to see ourselves the way we are. We can see what needs adjusted. We can see something that needs shortened. We can see something that needs cut off. We can see some messiness that needs straightened up. We can see some dirt that needs cleaned. But I said, if we see it, and then we leave and we don't do anything about it, we are just as foolish. He says, you're just like a person who's seen themselves in the mirror And then they walk away and forget what they look like. Wow, that's a rough picture, isn't it? That's the way lots of us do it. Every Sunday morning, or when we read the Word in our devotions at home, God will speak to us. We'll feel something uncomfortable, feel like, ooh, that's about me. And then before we even are out the door, we're laughing and talking with people, and we're done. We don't change anything. We don't fix up that mess. We don't clean up that impurity. We don't do anything. We need to choose to believe that knowledge demands action. Sometimes we get all caught up in thinking about the things we don't understand. And we want to go to prophecy seminars. And you know, we want to go to seminars on the gifts of the Spirit and all these different kinds of things. There's nothing wrong with that. But listen, if you don't understand the book of Revelation, don't worry about it. The only thing you should worry about are the things that you do understand and you're not obeying. See, that's where we need to get concerned. Knowledge demands action. Okay, wow. The next one's really tough. He says, I need to choose to think that my relationship with God is worthless when my mouth is out of control. Eesh, that's ouchy, isn't it? He doesn't say it's diminished a little bit. He doesn't say that you get a 95% if everything else is perfect and your mouth is out of control. He says that your relationship with God is worthless. My relationship with God is worthless when my mouth is out of control. As a matter of fact, it kind of sounds like zero tolerance, right? Zero tolerance. He says it is worthless. Wow. God doesn't say that an out-of-control mouth is a little problem, something to be tolerated. In fact, in this book alone, the entire chapter 3, the third week, is about that. The entire chapter is about taking care of your tongue because of the great messes that a tongue and talking and stuff can take. It says a person who appears to be religious, who can quote Scripture, who can argue doctrine, who can do all of that, but doesn't keep their tongue under control, doesn't keep from gossiping, doesn't quit saying things behind people's back, doesn't quit stirring up stuff. A person doesn't do that, says their religion is worthless. They're full of hot air. I didn't say that. God said that. That's what he said. A person who cannot bridle their tongue, who cannot be quiet and keep their mouth under control. Bridle is what keeps a horse in line. A person who can't, doesn't mean you can't say anything ever. A horse is allowed to move, but they got to move appropriately under direction. Anyone who can't bridle their tongue and let it move only under godly direction, their religion is worthless. Wow. You've heard it said, I'm sure. Great people talk about ideas. Average people talk about things. Small people talk about other people. And that's pretty much where it is. Okay, the last thing he says in this chapter about how we think is that we need to choose to think this way because it's true. God's priority is caring for the weak in a tough world and staying pure in a defiled world. Listen to what he said there. Religion that God our Father accepts as pure and faultless. If you were going to make a job description for a pure and faultless Christian, what would you say? We talked about it 2 weeks ago. We talked about what Jesus said. Jesus said that the greatest commandments are to, first of all, love God with all your soul, your mind, your strength, with everything that you are. Love God, that's the first one. And the second one is love your neighbor as yourself. And James says something that's very similar. He says you are to keep yourself unspotted, unblemished, keep yourself pure while you're in a dirty world, and then you're supposed to love and protect and care for the orphans and the widows, and they're used as a picture of the most weak and vulnerable among us. In their society, there were no assistance, no public assistance programs, no place for orphans to go. These were the weakest and the most vulnerable in all society. And he said, so if you want to have pure religion, religion that God considers pure, it's not how you dress, it's not how you look, it's not if you know all the doctrine, it's not how you do things politically, it's not any of that. How it is, it's how you keep yourself pure. Do you love God enough to keep yourself pure in a dirty world? And how do you treat the weak and the vulnerable? How do you do that? Do you love them that way? Wow. Jesus and James were on the exact same page. Now, you say, well, I don't see how keeping yourself pure is loving God. Oh, really? Really? The book of John, the entire book of John says that if you love him, you keep His commands. If you really love God, you're not trying to figure out what sin you can get by with. You're not trying to figure out how far you can go and still make heaven. If you really love God, you're wanting to please Him in all that you do. You're wanting to keep yourself clean. You're wanting to be there. You're wanting to be on the same page with Him. And here's the bottom line of all sin. I want you to think about it this morning. What was the last sin that you can remember you committed? For some of us, it was this morning. For some of us, it was last night. For some of us, it was this past week. And for some of you really good people, you may not be able to remember. I definitely can remember. I can definitely remember. Do you know what? Do you know what's the bottom line reason for every single sin? Every single sin, bottom line, one reason. In that moment, I loved something more than I loved God. You say, oh no, that's not the case. I was afraid. That's why I lied, because I was afraid. It wasn't that I didn't love God enough. Oh yeah, you loved your security more than you loved God. You loved your reputation more than you loved God. You loved your pleasure more than you loved God. You loved to be with her more than you loved God. Whatever it is, the bottom line of every single sin is because in that moment we love something more than we love God. Every single time. Pure religion means that I'm going to love God enough that every time when I'm tempted to choose something that He would not want, something He would not choose, I'm going to love Him enough to make His choice. And on the occasions that I fail, instead of excusing it and hiding it, I'm going to immediately own it. As soon as I realize it, I'm going to confess it, I'm going to ask for forgiveness, and I'm going to get back on the wagon again. I'm going to do it again. And then the second thing He says, that we're going to love the weak and most vulnerable. I'm going to have protective love. I'm going to care for the people who can't care for themselves. You know, if the people who are strong and powerful and, you know, have money and are attractive and all of those things, the people that we can get a reward from, they're easy to love, right? At least easy to act like we love them because there's a reward. But what He's telling us, pure religion, religion that God accepts, is that loves the person that there's no reward in the way the world thinks for loving them. Now, religion, it can cause so many problems. That's why we talk a lot about relationship and not much about religion. But here, that's the word that God uses, pure religion. Occasionally, I'll hear something about old-time religion. Sometimes somebody will watch the web, or we'll have a visitor at our church who will then, either through one of their friends or through a letter email to me or a comment, will say, wow, a woman preacher. Or, a woman preacher with earrings? Or, a lady wearing slacks in the pulpit? Or, what's up with those songs that you sing? I haven't heard a hymn any time I've watched this program. Or, you guys have chairs, you don't have pews? And then occasionally someone will say something about, man, I'm hungry for some old-time religion. Really? If you're hungry for that, friend, we just serve some up. Old-time religion. Old-time religion. Loving God so much that you stay pure from the world. Loving God so much that you sacrificially love people who can give you nothing back. That's what God calls old-time religion. Do you remember that song? Some of you are old enough to remember that song. Give me that old-time religion. If you remember it, sing it with me. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. Give me that old-time religion. It's good enough for me. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. Makes me love everybody. And it's good enough for me. It will make me pure and holy. It will make me pure and holy. It will make me pure and holy. It's good enough for me. Now here's a good one. Here's a good verse. Not everybody sings this one, but it's in the original lyrics. Just think about this. Let's just say that when you leave today, you get in a car accident. And I had a friend die this way. Say you're in this car accident, and it's so volatile, and your car is going to explode, and they can't get anybody to you right away. You're pinned in. They're going to have to cut you out. But it looks like, unless there's a huge miracle, your car is going to explode before they can get you out. You're laying there in that car. What are you thinking? I'll tell you what I'm thinking right now. I'm thinking you need some old-time religion. And I hope you have it. Because if you had it and you were in that situation, you would not be laying there pinned in that car. Oh, God, help me. Will somebody pray with me? Oh, God, help me. Will someone pray with me? You wouldn't be trying to confess all your sins because they'd be up to date, man. You'd be trying to stay as clean as you could. You wouldn't be wishing you could talk to your husband or wife or your kids and tell them how sorry you are for the way you acted that morning. You wouldn't be wishing you'd been nicer to that girl at work that no one wants to be talked to. You wouldn't have any of that stuff parading around your head. You know why? Because you'd have some old-time religion. And your old-time religion would make you ready for this. That's why that verse goes, it will do when I am dying. It will do when I am dying. It will do when I am dying. And it's good enough for me. It will take us all to heaven. It will take us all to heaven. It will take us all to heaven, and it's good enough for me. What is? Loving God so much that you choose His way. You choose purity in a dirty world. Loving God so much that you have a sacrificial love for people who can do nothing for you in return. That's religion God gives a thumbs up to. Pray with me. Lord Jesus, the way we think determines everything. Everything. Help us to have your mind. I pray that you would work in me and that you would continue to convict me in areas that are not like you, and that I would continue to say yes. I know that's all up to me. I pray that you would help me to continue to grow. I pray that for all of these people here, people that you love, people that you died for, people that you want to take to heaven one day. Help us to live in a way that shows your love in this world. And it all starts with how we think about what you said. Amen. Amen. I'm going to ask the ushers to come and give you an opportunity to give your tithes and gifts to the Lord. If you're watching by way of the web, there's a click to donate button there too. And we appreciate all the help that you give us in fulfilling the mission that God has given us to do here. I want to remind you that there are so many things going on, we can't tell you all about them. So there's a loop up here, and there's lots of information in your worship folder. Check those out. Lots of small groups starting. One cool thing that's coming up I got to tell you about today, because this is your last chance to sign up. Married life. If you're a married couple, you don't want to miss married life this Saturday night. It's at 7 o'clock. It's only $10 per couple, and there's no dinner this time. It's not a dinner, but it's a movie kind of theme, a movie night. And there's movie food, popcorn and cotton candy and stuff like that, that kind of stuff. It's going to be great, great fun. And here's why, if you're a married couple, you need to come. You need to come because it will give you a great big super mega dose of a great vitamin for your marriage as you head into the fall and the holidays. It'll be so much fun. You'll have a great time. There's going to be comedy there. Superintendent Mike McFerrin and his wife Robin, who have a great marriage of about 40 years, and they're intriguing, wonderful speakers. They're going to be here. They'll give it won't be long. It'll be very entertaining. Pep talk for your marriage, give you some great, great advice. It's actually a fun way to get some counseling. It's really, really good. Going to be a great time, great group of people there. Only $10. We hope you'll sign up at the Welcome Center today to come. Many other good things going on. Check them out in the worship folder. Now, I need to tell you two pieces of information that require your prayers, all right? The first one is that if you were at LEAP, you worked here at LEAP during the day on Saturday, you know that we had a young man, a soldier, that had just returned from Afghanistan. This was his first full day that he was home on his leave, and he worked here for us that day, delivering water. His name was Kim, and many of you got to know him. When his mother, Vicki Gray, comes here to church in a very real and awful tragedy, Kim was murdered a couple weeks ago. Now, if you read the stories, first of all, unnamed, about the 33-year-old man that was killed in Cuyahoga Falls, from Cuyahoga Falls, that was Kim Slako, and he left a wife and two stepchildren, and his mother and father as well. And we want to pray for that family. It's very, very tragic. They have requested that any memorial donations be made to the Cornerstone project for the homeless or to LEAP. And so if you know Kim, if you want to respond in that way, that's great. And we do ask you to seriously and over a period of time pray for his family. Second one, Jan Lepley's mother went to be with the Lord, a really great, exciting thing for her. She went to heaven this week, and calling hours are this afternoon from 2 to 4 and 7 to 9 this evening at the Hopkins Lauber Home in Uniontown, and the memorial service will be tomorrow morning at 11 at the Greensburg United Methodist Church. And we encourage you to participate in letting Jan and her family know how loved they are. I want to tell you, last of all, next Sunday is going to be so much fun. We have two huge surprises, and if you are not here, you will truly be square, okay? Actually, you're going to be so disappointed if you're not here, because everyone is going to be talking about these two big surprises, and you will hate it that you missed it. In fact, we are swearing the first service to secrecy, so they won't tell you before you come in, okay? Two big surprises, and they're going to be great fun. Next Sunday, it's about faith and works, what God has to say about the way we act, how we act. Don't miss it. It's going to be a great day. Stand with me, please, and receive the blessing of the Lord. May Jesus Christ fill you to overflowing so that his love splashes on everyone you meet this day and every day until that great day. We are all the way home. Amen.